Welcome everybody. We are going to talk about Cassandra and Elasticsearch. I'm Rémi Trouville. It's my first Cassandra submit. And I was leading an application telecom expert team in a bank insurance group before joining an executive MBA that brings me here.
Hello, I'm Vincent Royer. I am leading a database expert team in a bank insurance group where we manage day-to-day operation for various databases, including NoSQL and including Elasticsearch and Cassandra.
We have been working together for 8 years in the same office with Vincent, so we are kind of friends. We are French, as our accent can prove it easily. We came from France, especially for the event, and we did not bring any stinky cheese, if you may ask. we are very amazed to be in front of you. So welcome and thanks you all. I would like to start by a little survey. So please raise your hand if you are using Cassandra. It's an easy one. I would like to know. Okay, perfect. Raise your hand if you know Elasticsearch. Who knows Elasticsearch? Perfect. And raise your hand if you have ever moved data from Cassandra to Elasticsearch or the other way around, from Elasticsearch to Cassandra. Okay, great. And the last one, raise your hand if you know Elassandra, our product. Yeah, okay. Vince, how everything starts?
Yes, in fact, 20 months ago, we were brainstorming with some colleagues about the best solution for NoSQL solutions and to fit all our needs. And basically, our developers wanted to use Elasticsearch for the application developments. And as database administrators, we wanted Cassandra because we could do maintenance operation during business hours. So I just wrote on one day on a slide, it would be very nice to have Elasticsearch inside Cassandra, but it was just a joke. And nobody took it seriously. Back to them, I spent some nights to read the Elasticsearch code and the Cassandra code, and I started to develop it on my own. And I came last year, it was just a prototype, and now it's running.
At the same time, CEO, a friend of mine, told me when my customer complains, calling the support line about something that went wrong just a few minutes ago, 1 hour can elapse before I can answer because my data from my Cassandra cluster are not already and directly imported into my Elasticsearch cluster. So we thought there is a real need combining the two. Vince started a second job during his nights and weekends coding Elassandra. Beginning 2016, the product was okay. NoSQL community seemed to be interested on GitHub about it. So in May, we apply to be here and show you this worthwhile solution. And now today we are here and we hope it's just the start of an exciting journey in the big data world. Today we have three main objectives. We want to share our vision and excitement about it. We want to receive feedback. As it's an open source code, we need feedback from community and all feedbacks are welcomed. And also meet some experts to exchange ideas and beers. Here is the agenda for the session. We will mainly focus on part 2 and 3 for you to understand how Elassandra works. We will go through our ecosystem with Kibana, Spark, and so on. And after a quick look at the roadmap, we will answer all your questions and answer. Today, we are using Elassandra on non-critical data, as we consider it still as a beta version. And we target to be production ready for end 2016. So now, we are going to dive into some technical stuff. Vincent will explain how Elassandra works.
So I'll start with the Elasticsearch design. There's a master node that manages and broadcasts cluster state to all other nodes. the master node is involved each time the mapping is updated and when a node start or stop. You also have some primary nodes that for reads and for write operations. And you've got replica nodes that you can increase to increase your search throughput. And to be clear, Elasticsearch is a very good product with very amazing features. But as a Cassandra big fan, and I guess there's in the room, you're probably wondering what's happening if you lose the master node, or if you have a network partition, or even if how to scale the primary nodes to increase your write throughput. So we will see how Elassandra design solved this. We've put the Elasticsearch services inside the Cassandra GVM, and documents are stored in Cassandra. And when it's stored in the Cassandra, a custom secondary index automatically index it in the Elasticsearch layer. So we kept the JSON REST API from Elasticsearch and the secure one from Cassandra. So you've got on each node you can request with the two API. One thing that's very important is that the you index data, it's synchronous. So it updates the Elasticsearch indices every time you write in a Cassandra table. So let's see how we map some concept from Elasticsearch to Cassandra. The Elasticsearch mapping is like the SQL schema in Cassandra, where you have many virtual data centers in a Cassandra cluster. And Elasticsearch is mapped to only one data center in Elassandra. We decided also to have to map an Elasticsearch index to a key space, where each document type is backed by a Cassandra table. And of course, an Elasticsearch document is stored as a row in a Cassandra table. And each field of that document is a column in the SQL schema. And last, for a nested object, we used user-defined types. And we will see later how it's done. So let's look at on the write path. When you use the Elasticsearch REST API, you send a document to the Elasticsearch layer. First of all, it checks that you don't need any mapping update. But we'll see this a little bit later. And then it writes into Cassandra with a SQL insert, converting the JSON document to a Cassandra row. This row is sent to replica nodes. And on each replica nodes, the secondary index puts the document inside a shard in Elasticsearch layer. As we do this, we include a token number, which is the Cassandra token ring. For every document, you can compute a token, and that's what we put in with the document.
Let's have a look at the search
pass. Yes. In the search pass, again, you request for a search on the Elasticsearch layer. Then the search is broadcasted to all shards in the data center. We had a token filter to avoid duplicate results. If your replication factor is greater than one, you may have some duplicate results. So the token filter avoid this. And back on the coordinator node, from the IDs of resulting from the search, we fetch a requested field from the Cassandra layer. So for example, if we request the source of the document, it will issue a select with all fields of that document in the Cassandra layer.
And back the response.
And back, of course, back we send a JSON document as a response to the client. Let's have a look on the cluster state. There is three main sections. The first one is the cluster information with the cluster name and node names. And node names are now Cassandra host IDs. You've got the metadata, your data structure definitions. This is the main part of your configuration. And then in green, you've got the routing table. This routing table is computed locally by each node from the token map of Cassandra. Let's see how the mapping is managed. The mapping, that means our data structure, is stored in the Elasticsearch admin metadata table in the Cassandra, in Cassandra layer. But this mapping is also stored in the system schema, system key space. And this allows us to start very early Elasticsearch services when a node starts. And on Bootstrap, it allows to pull from other node data and to index it while we are pulling data. And so that provides during Bootstrap a kind of resharding of your Elasticsearch layer. And on node startup, because we have started the Elasticsearch layer, we can replay commit logs and index data directly. So we have removed from Elasticsearch layer the transaction log because it does the same thing as a commit log in Cassandra. The architecture of Elassandra is masterless. And to do this, we are using a Paxos transaction. Each time we update the mapping, a Paxos transaction ensures that no concurrent modification occurs. And then when the update succeeds, we use the gossip protocol to tell to all other nodes to reload the mapping from the Cassandra layer and to set their mapping version number in the gossip layer. So every node reloads and applies the new mapping. And when all nodes in the data center have applied the new mapping, the mapping update is completed.
This is a really important stuff. Elassandra makes Elasticsearch masterless thanks to the Paxos transaction. Yesterday in the summit, someone came to us and was afraid about response time and time consuming regarding a Paxos transaction. So I will give you the same answer. Paxos transaction is only done when there is a mapping change, when a mapping change occurs, so not so often. Let's have a look at the cross data replication.
Yes, because the mapping is stored in a Cassandra table as a row, you can replicate it on several data centers. And they can share the same mapping and same cluster definition. So you can have the same Elasticsearch cluster on many data centers. Here you've got two data centers sharing the same mapping and same data. And then you can plug, for example, a Kibana visualization tool on the same data on two data centers. Compared to pure Elasticsearch, Elassandra brings cross data center replication and all Cassandra anti-entropy features like intend off, repair, read repair, and so on, ensure data consistency for you. Let's see how we've done a backup and restore. Cassandra naturally flushes main tables on disk to build backups, and this also flushes secondary indices. That works for our Elasticsearch indices, and it involves a flush of loose end files. Then, like Cassandra SS table, you just have to back up loose end files and SS table together to make a consistent snapshot. Of course, you can also restore only your SS table and rebuild your Elasticsearch indices, but it's much more resource consuming. This is pretty cool because you can use Cassandra as a primary data store for Elasticsearch, and you can back up both Cassandra data and Elasticsearch indices.
So I hope you understand a little bit more how Elassandra works, and we are going to go through cool features introduced by Elassandra.
So from the beginning, I wanted to keep the Elasticsearch layer unchanged from the user perspective. So under the hood, on each mapping update, Elassandra automatically generates the SQL schema. You don't need to worry about it. It's just use the Elasticsearch API. You can notice that, for example, here I've put a tweet, and it has generated the SQL schema. And you see that all fields are backed by a list of something. This is because by default, Elasticsearch fields are multivalued, but you can also force the mapping to use a native type like just a single string or a single integer. And if you are a Cassandra expert, I guess there's here, you can also build the Elasticsearch mapping from the SQL schema. I've introduced a new discover parameter where you say which columns would be discovered automatically by Elassandra. For example, here, all columns with the following regular expression. And then it automatically creates your mapping from your existing Cassandra table. So this is a nice feature because in Elasticsearch, we kept the dynamic mapping, and it automatically creates the Cassandra schema.
That means that for Elasticsearch user, they don't need to learn SQL to be able to use Elassandra. Here is also a cool feature for nested documents coming from Elasticsearch.
For nested document, we have used user-defined types dynamically generated from the Elasticsearch mapping. It is recursive, so you can have many layers of nested document. And for example, here you've got a name with a field first and last. And you can see the associated Cassandra type in the Cassandra schema. And moreover, you can see that you've got a custom secondary index for each top-level field in the table user, which is the layer where we store all documents for the type of document user. Another cool feature is that you can index the content of a Cassandra table in many Elasticsearch indices. You can have, for example, an index for a column E and B in your table, and another index for a column B and C. But this is very useful if you want to change your Elasticsearch mapping, for example. Then you create a new index backed by the same key space, but with a new mapping. You rebuild this index, and you can use the Cassandra command node tool rebuild index. It rebuild the index. And when the index is rebuilt, you just have to move your index alias from the old one to the new one. And that's done. You've changed the mapping. Another feature is that we'll introduce this partitioned index. You can have many. You can also have many indices for a key space content, but only index a Cassandra row in a specific index. For example, we've got logs with a field with a date field, and depending on the value of this date field, it generates the target index. For example, for logs from 2015, it goes in a log of 2015. And when your logs becoming too old, you just have to remove all the indices. And of course, in the Cassandra table, you can use a default TTL to remove all data. And we have used this to store and visualize the web and application logs very easily. We were needed to guarantee the storage of the logs for compliance reasons and audits. And Cassandra fulfilled these needs with backups. We also needed to be able to scale out to increase the write throughput. And this was achieved by adding new nodes with automatic resharding on Bootstrap. And finally, we needed to be 100% available on write because our application send log 24 hours a day. And that was possible because of Cassandra.
Okay, I hope it's becoming more and more and more clear. We will go through the ecosystem Elassandra is in, and it starts with Kibana. Elassandra is compatible with Kibana. Kibana is a great tool to visualize data and make some great graphs, but I'm sure everybody knows that. And Kibana's configuration is in Cassandra, like all other Elasticsearch indices. And Elassandra also, there are also other plugins we are compatible with.
Yes, by doing a minimum change in the Elasticsearch layer, all plugins remain compatible with Elassandra, So tools like Logstage or Bits are fully compatible with Elassandra because they request the Elasticsearch layer. But we have also tested some plugins like Elastic HQ, which is a monitoring plugin with a screenshot there. We've tested the Elasticsearch SQL plugin, allowing to request Elasticsearch in SQL. And even the GDBC SQL for ES, developed by Anchorman. It's a GDBC driver for Elasticsearch. It works with Elassandra, so you can request Cassandra with a standard GDBC request, making select, group by. That's pretty cool. We have also used Presto DB. Presto DB is a distributed SQL engine with connector for Hadoop, MySQL, Redis, and many other sources, of, including Cassandra. The main advantage, it can make joins between two Cassandra tables in memory. But Presto DB can't write back the result of a query to a database. It's intended to do interactive analytics. So we wrote our little utility, SQL Inject, to write back the result of a query back to Cassandra, indexed by Elasticsearch and visualized with Kibana. So we were able to pull data from various SQL databases, make joins in Cassandra, index it with Elasticsearch, and build a very very useful dashboard with Kibana for our users.
With this, you can produce some nice report, and your user will be happy doing their own dashboard. To sum up, I want to say also for if you are using Presto DB and you are waiting an Elasticsearch connector, you can use it. You can use Elassandra. And Elassandra also runs with Spark, Vince.
Yes, in a previous slide, you may notice that SQL Inject is not very scalable. It's just a 1 GVM, so you can write back the result of a huge query. But if you want to do this, you can use Spark. I've slightly modified the Elasticsearch Hadoop connector from Elasticsearch to be able to run with Elassandra. And actually, it works. So the main advantage is that you can locate Spark worker with Elassandra nodes and scale both together as your need grows. And the other main benefit is that this connector, Elasticsearch for Hadoop, support pushdown for a Spark data frame. So you've got very good results to aggregate some results from your source data. We have also used Elassandra to manage time series. We've put our time series basically in Cassandra. And we only have indexed in Elasticsearch metadata about those time series. We were able to enrich this metadata by doing joins with many sources of data from SQL databases or any other Cassandra tables. And at the end, we were able to do graphs with, for example, all the machine on the same type or all the machine hosting the same application as was very useful for our users to do diagnosis or capacity plannings.
Not that this is something we have already done, like other stuff we are presenting this morning. We run a little benchmark. But before going through the numbers, I want to stress out that Elassandra is simpler to use for those who raise their hand moving data from Elasticsearch to Cassandra, because it's only Elassandra is only one product, and when you want to compare numbers, you have to compare from Elassandra cluster to Elasticsearch plus Cassandra clusters. So we can go through the numbers.
Yes, we've done a little write throughput benchmark, and as you can see on the left, you've got Cassandra only, and on the right, Elassandra nodes. It's a two-node cluster running on GVM from Google. You can notice that we have roughly the same throughput in write, but our server is not overloaded. We have 20 to 40% CPU on Cassandra and 60 to 80% CPU on Elassandra. This is because we are doing much more thing, of course. Indexing come with a cost. The garbage collector is also working harder. And you can notice we have here in Cassandra about 6,000 classes loaded. And in Elassandra, we've got 12,000 loaded classes because we do much more things. And you also have 200 threads in a Cassandra node, but you have 350 threads in the Elassandra node. So you should put much more CPU on your Elassandra nodes to get the performance you expected.
And now the roadmap. Our goal is to make Elassandra an enterprise-grade solution. So to do that, we will continue improving the documentation, the code, and the packaging. We will also upgrade to Cassandra 3 and Elasticsearch 2.4 or latest. And we will finish coding all the security features around Elassandra to make it production ready and deliver some professional services, including support. We put some more information on the website, elassandra.io. The source, the open source code is on the GitHub, and we put some other material like video and the blog. I want to take advantage to be here in front of you, tell you that we appreciate feedback, positive feedback, negative feedback. All feedbacks are welcome. We have nice t-shirts, so we will be around the area in the summit today and tomorrow also. So if you want to ask any questions about Elassandra or if you want to have a demo, we will be very pleased. And we will be at the bar tonight. Huh? Mm-hmm. Tonight we will be at the bar.
Yes.
And thanks to
okay.
you.
We are available for any demo or later, yeah. As you want.
Thanks for questions and answer. Is the next slide.
Is there a mic?
I will repeat.
Okay. So I have two questions. The first one is, you showed for time series data, you showed using date window compaction strategy.
Yeah.
Is that configurable? Because time window compaction strategy is the new hotness.
No need to repeat, huh? Everybody heard? Yeah,
it's about date compaction strategy. Of course, we will go to the time window compaction strategy when we will be running with Cassandra 3.
Okay. So. My second question had to do with protection of existing Cassandra tables and schemas. In my case, I've got some tables where we really kind of don't make use of the dynamic schema abilities. We really need the data to be what it is, and it would really kind of be a problem if somebody could just post something that would insert a random incorrect document into our, into
okay.
our data.
In Elasticsearch, you can set for an index if you enable or disable the dynamic mapping to block any mapping update. And you can also block an index in read or write. For example, you can block write. So you can block everything you want on the Elasticsearch layer.
Thank you.
And you can have in a table, you can have some field indexed in Elasticsearch and the others not indexed. For example, you can have blob fields not indexed in Elasticsearch and metadata about your pictures indexed in Elasticsearch.
Nice.
Just curious, did you guys do any kind of performance testing comparing Solr and Elassandra or SATSI or any other secondary indexes with Elassandra?
We didn't know do some benchmarks together because we need many resources to do those benchmarks. But it's the beginning of the project, and I think we will do it later.
Okay. And then a secondary question. What kind of performance do you guys see building your indexes from scratch?
In the right benchmark, you see we were writing from scratch. There was no data in Cassandra. We were injecting with a SQL driver. We were injecting data. And this built the Elasticsearch index. Of course, it comes with a cost, but as Elasticsearch and Cassandra are scalable, you can add more nodes and distribute your write loads on many nodes.
So just kind of a more in-depth question, I guess, is more specifically, how many records did you guys index and what was the timeline?
In our environment for test, we had four nodes, 400 gigabytes per node. It's about one tera and a half globally, with small servers with 24 CPU and 32 gigabyte RAM.
And how many documents did you index?
We went up to, the most we've done is about 500 billion. In fact, it really depends on your CPU. If you take, for example, if you take a little GVM from Google with only one vCPU, we have a rate of 3 or 4 or 7 write per second. And if you take a GVM with 16 vCPU, we were about 30,000 write per second. So it's tightly bound to your CPU. What do you mean? Sorry.
So when you guys ran these tests,
yeah,
these exact instances, yeah, you said that you indexed 500 billion records.
Yeah.
I'm just curious on how long that took.
I can't remember. We were just looking at the throughput. It's 30,000 write per second.
Okay.
Yeah.
But he was taking the same time to write on this and other data.
Yes. Yes, because we had the same throughput, so it was roughly the same.
It doesn't add latency on the
write. As soon as your node is not overloaded, because of course, if your CPU reaches more than 80% CPU, your throughput is beginning to decrease, of course.
But otherwise, there is no change.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So DataStax package is Solar on Cassandra.
Yeah.
So how do you compare that package to Elasticsearch?
For us, the main focus was to do it with Elasticsearch because our developer wanted to use Elasticsearch. So they want Elasticsearch because of their there's many cool features like nested document or a query many indices in one time, some stuff like that, or suggester is better, nested document.
But it's a kind of the same kind of solution, no? It's Cassandra plus a search engine. Cassandra, it's not the same search engine.
Yes, but it is in fact loose and file under the hood.
Question over there.
What is the cost of upgrading? So a new version of Cassandra, a new version of Elasticsearch, what's the impact by having this?
In fact, we tried to do the minimum modification in the code from Cassandra and from Elasticsearch. There is about 170 classes modified in Elasticsearch code, over 3,000 files. So it's less than 5% of the code that is changed. And in Cassandra layer, we have to just put some around 10 classes modified to manage the bootstrap phase in Cassandra. So each time a new version of Cassandra and Elasticsearch is delivered, we have to merge our modification with the one of the new version.
Yeah.
I'm assuming you have Elasticsearch and Cassandra co-located on the same node. Is there a way that you can separate Elasticsearch and Cassandra into separate clusters that are periodically
hold the same? Now that's tightly integrated, and we can separate anymore Elasticsearch and Cassandra. The only thing you could do is to take your Lucene files and to put those files in your an Elasticsearch layer cluster, new cluster, and restart your indices with the, this lucene files.
But the import-export processes is what we try to avoid. So yeah. That's why it's
we want in real-time indexing. So
This is the end. It's written in the paper. Okay, thanks a lot, everybody.
Thanks a lot.